It's good to be with you again here, and I trust you had a good week, especially from last week, the week that we had here, as we said farewell to Brother Joshua. And this week we are saying welcome to Brother Ajith and his wife Shobin. So it'll be an exciting service. We had a service at 9 o'clock here where we welcomed the new elder, Brother Ajith, or Brother Nick and Ginger. And it was a great, great celebration, great service. And so in line with that, what I want to do is take a look at the word elder as we install our elders this morning. And that's what the brief devotional, what I'm doing this morning. And it may be a bit of a different service than usual. We will even have handouts for you. But it's just something I believe as a church periodically is good to do to make sure we're all on the same page for that. If you have your Bibles, please turn to Numbers chapter 11. We'll talk about elders and the congregation. I've talked about this here before when I talked about the role of the Holy Spirit. And this was a time in Numbers 11 when Moses had just taken, God had told him to take the nation out of Egypt, and they were busy wandering through the desert. And the work was too much, and there was a lot of grumbling going on and stuff. It wasn't all that good. God says, you get the 70 elders, people who are respected, people who are elders, not just in age. It was had related to age as well, but people who are proven to be mature, and call them together. Because what he said, I'm going to do is I'm going to put my spirit as it is on you. I'm going to put it onto them. And so that's exactly what he did. And they were ratified as 70 elders at that time. And that term, elders, pitches up many times in the scriptures. And here's one of the first of the times. Let's take a look at it. Numbers 11, verse 16 and 17. And then I'm reading from the New Living Translation. Then the Lord said to Moses, gather before me 70 men who are recognized as elders and leaders of Israel. Bring them to the tabernacle to stand there with you. I will come down and talk to you there. I will take some of the spirit that is upon you, and I will put the spirit upon them also. They will bear the burden of the people among you, with you, so that you will not have to carry it alone. And then skip down to verse 25. It says here, and the Lord came down in the cloud and spoke to Moses. Then he gave the 70 elders the same spirit that was upon Moses. And when the spirit rested upon them, they prophesied. Pray, Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you for your word. I thank you, Lord, for Brother Ajith and his wife, Shobin. Thank you for their lives, for their willingness, O Lord, to give oversight to this congregation. We commit ourselves to you this morning. We commit to you this word. Commit our ears to you that we can hear what you're saying to us as a church. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So the term elders comes through in the Old Testament, starting from here, right through, right up until the time of Jesus, and in the time of when the temple was there. And this word will come either in Hebrew or its Greek equivalent from here on right through to Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Now, the term elders is used, of course, in twofold, basically in the Old Testament, two times or two in two different ways. Number one, elders of the nation of Israel. So as a nation, in addition to the leadership here, it's under Moses. At other times, it would be under certain prophets or under certain judges or even under the kings. And they would always work together with those that God has assigned, whether it's the judge, or the prophets, or the kings. Incidentally, as we know, God's plan was not to have any kings, or at least not at the timing, and at the timing that the people wanted. And Samuel took that at first as a personal offense, and God says, relax, it's not you they rejected, it's me. He said, give us a king like everybody else. And so they're used to one man running it and dictating to everyone, even though it was going to be horrible for them. But if you read actually quite closely, God's plan is always to make it quite clear that it's a theocracy. That's the way God runs things. He's in control. He's in charge. And what he does as the great shepherd, he distributes the workload among other sub-shepherds in that way. And in the Old Testament, the word that is used there a lot is elders. And it's the elders of the nation. And also then as time develops, you'll see also the word elders used in the elders of a city. They're the men who sit at the city gate. They do a lot of the judging. They do a lot of the, in the truest sense, the gatekeeping. They're the ones who keep their eyes and their ears open to what happens in a city, and they govern what goes on. So that's over in the Old Testament. We are New Testament people, not Old Testament people, so we'll move on to the New Testament. Let's turn to Acts chapter 11. Acts 11, verse 30. Now the word, as I mentioned, elders, pitches up several times. In Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and it also it comes up in the book of Acts a number of times, but it's usually in a negative sense because it was the elders who were in cahoots with the Sanhedrin and so forth, and they gave Jesus the most opposition. But they were the ones who set the pace for the nation, and that's exactly what Jesus came to set them free from, because they were hanging on to traditions rather than hanging on to God of the traditions, and they had that all mixed up. And it's not until you get to Acts chapter 11 and verse 30, this is the first time that the word elders is used now in the church, and because the concept is good, it's just that the people were abusing the position in the other places, steering them away from God. The word here is presbyteros. The term can be said of a mature man having seasoned judgment. I like that. A mature man with seasoned. It's like when you marinate this nice juicy steak, it just let it marinate for 24 hours, seasoned well. And life does that. Life has a way of seasoning people. Go through the ups and downs, and you learn. And after a while, you learn to make judgments, proper judgments. And it's based on experience. Hence the term elder. And you turn a few pages to Acts 14 and verse 23, and you'll notice that this word elders comes up many times, Acts 14 and 23. Paul and Barnabas also appointed elders in every church. With prayer and fasting, they turned the elders over to the care of the Lord in whom they had put their trust. This is very, very crucial in Paul's way of doing ministry. As an apostle, he would travel, establish churches. And once there's a group of core people who are gathering together to pray, he would commit them to the elders, commit the elders to the Lord. And that church was then up on its own. And what you'll find is that it's interesting, because the Apostle Paul, we know him, at least the way I read him, and you sort of get this picture of Paul, this very feisty man with lots of energy who comes blazing into town, and every town he comes into, he basically creates a civil, can't say disorder, because he was the one who brought it into order, but a civil riot, because he, through the preaching of the gospel, he could actually change the entire economics. He could change the social strata. Everything he could change, not because of what he did, but because of the power of the gospel. He came in the power of the gospel, and he changed things. Just the status quo didn't remain the same. So we get this picture of this tremendously aggressive and almost, you can use the word, dominating, authoritative type person. However, he understood his apostleship, that he was called of God. Man didn't call him. No council called him. No church elders called him. Nothing. He was called of God. He knew it. He understood it. Yet, with all that, what happens was, for example, in the Corinthians, when he wrote them after he left, there was a problem in the Corinthian church, and he writes to them, and he says, look, if I were there with you, this is what I would do. Now, we would say, He's the apostle. He can call the shots. But he doesn't. He just said, this is what I would do. And he says, however, he's basically writing to the elders and to the congregation. He says, you do. You decide what to do. And that's exactly what they decide. Then you read 2 Corinthians, and you can read there that he actually says, you made a good choice. Okay, so he didn't override them. He didn't use any veto power. There's something that the Apostle Paul, in all of his energy that he had, in the strength of this being this trailblazer, this pioneer, he understood that once he turned the church over to elders, let the elders run it. And then you find this word elders starting from Acts 11 onward. There, where it's interesting here is if you look now, if you just go a bit further to chapter 15 and verses 2, 4, and 6, something very interesting that happens in the structure of the early church, and it's there in Jerusalem. Notice the combination of two words that always pitch up together here. Look at this, verse 2. Paul and Barnabas disagreed with them, arguing vehemently. That has to do with the argument there was to deal with circumcision and what does a Jew who becomes a Christian, what does he continue to do, what does he stop doing, and so forth. Okay, because Paul is one by faith alone, and others said, no, it's not quite that way. Anyways, so they disagree. Finally, verse 2, halfway down. Finally, the church decided to send Paul and Barnabas to Jerusalem, accompanied by some local believers, to talk to, notice who they're talking to, apostles and elders. So already in the early church in Jerusalem, where you've got it, basically, we had a tendency to assume that it was just run by the apostles. Actually, that wasn't the case. It was the apostles and the elders. Okay, go to verse 4. When they arrived in Jerusalem, Barnabas and Paul were welcomed by the whole church, including the apostles and elders. And then verse 6, so the apostles and elders met together to resolve this issue. And so right from the beginning in the church, you see, yes, there's this apostolic calling that the 12 had. One had died, one was replaced now. But when it comes to the running of the local church, it was the elders who were there, and the apostles coming alongside them. And after a while, by the time you get to the rest of Paul's letters, the apostolic part drops away when it comes to the governance of a local church, and you're just left with the elders that are there talking here. So move on a little bit. A couple of decades later, we go to 1 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 1. Now, Paul is not only is he planting churches, but he's bringing younger guys with him and helping him with this ministry that he has. 1 Timothy 3:1. And throughout the church, and you have to remember now, the church is starting to grow. Eh? There's starting to be this new move of Christianity growing up everywhere. Things aren't... We're 2,000 years beyond the New Testament. Human nature doesn't change very much. You always find people, you can find it in social clubs in our societies, you can find it in politics, you can find it in different places. There's always people who want and have a thirsting and a craving for position and power and titles. They're there. That's just as sure as the sun rises in the morning and sets in the evening, there's always people who want position, and they'll do anything to get it. I read a bit of humor into 1 Timothy 3:1 because in the church also they would get together some believers, and he says, okay, so some of you want to be elders, some of you want to be overseers, you want the office of an overseer? It's okay, no problem. Here's the qualifications. And then you list the qualifications, and I'm sure a good chunk of them would be immediately dismissed. Point being is that it's a fearful thing to be called of God and appointed by man to oversee, to be given and entrusted to the spiritual welfare of other people. We can't take it lightly. What we're doing here this morning is we install and ratify the eldership of Brother Ajith. This is not a light thing. He has just added on a layer of responsibility that if anybody would avoid. Who would want that kind of responsibility? And if people desire that kind of responsibility, to me a red flag comes up and says, this is a problem. Do you understand what you're getting into? And I can honestly say I'm so thankful that Brother Ajith, when we talked about this, this wasn't in his heart at all for any aspiration or anything. It was simply there was a need here in the service, as there was at 9 o'clock. And Brother Nick responded to the need, as Brother Ajith responded to the need for the 11 o'clock, to respond to a need to take up the office of an elder here for the congregation. So I just want to say thank you, Brother, for your willingness to do that and the humility that you portray in doing that. And with this, and this is what Paul says here. And he gives a list. You can read it here. By the way, this is for our TLC as a church, the Lighthouse Church. These are the same qualifications that are there. It's here in Timothy and also in Titus, the same qualifications for being a TLC council member. And another word of a way of rephrasing a council member is elder. So we have church elders, and now we have service elders in this. And this morning we've got two, right? Sister Bebin and Joyce. Am I missing somebody else? We've got two council members, eh? Okay, and Brother Ajith, as many of you know, was for years the vice president of the council. So functioning as elders for the overall of functioning of the church, then specifically for the service, is Brother Ajith. Now, the word, sorry, if we could just hit the button, there's going to pop up here. The Greek word for this word, elder, is episcopate. It's a bit different than the other one that was presbyteros. And sometimes people say, well, then therefore there's a big difference between these two. Well, let's go to the next verse of Titus. Because when, just like Paul worked with Timothy, he also worked with Titus. Let's take a look at Titus 1, verses 5, 6, and 7. Titus 1, 5, 6, and 7. I left you on the island of Crete so you could complete our work. Notice he uses our, not your work or my work, but our work there. And appoint elders, plural, okay, in each town as I instructed you. An elder must live a blameless life. He must be faithful to his wife, and his children must be believers who don't have a reputation for being wild or rebellious. For an elder must live a blameless life. He must not be arrogant, quick-tempered. He must not be a heavy drinker, violent, or dishonest with money. And it goes on for a whole bunch of lists of things. Now, what's interesting about these lists here is it talks not so much about the leadership giftings, but rather just of personal character. And for God, that's always the most important, developing character. And it is the job of the office of the elder of this 11 o'clock service to ensure that each one who calls this service a home service, that your giftings that God has given to you flourish and multiply. Notice how in Acts, there was a distinction between apostles and elders. Because apostles, as Paul later talks in Ephesians 4, these are giftings of God. What we're doing today is an appointment by man. Okay? In the early church, there were only two offices in the church, elders and deacons. Those are the only two. Ratification, appointed, selected. And we find the first time in Acts when they were looking for the food distribution, you know, that dilemma they had. And they said, the apostle says, listen, we can't be spending our time with this. And so let's call seven men who are capable. And the standard for them was quite high, to be full of the Holy Spirit. For anyone to work in the church, even distribute the food, was quite a high standard. I think if we had that high standard today, that would be nice. To be full of the Holy Spirit, even to be the janitor in a church, to sweep. You see, if we understand what church is not a society, it's not a club. It is the living body of Jesus Christ. And its organizational structure is different. The standards are different. Because we're not looking at a hierarchical pyramid system whereby you've got all your CEOs and all kind of stuff. No, God gives his gifts to people. And this is going to be the job of Brother Ajith as an elder of this service, is to listen to the Holy Spirit and to watch what giftings are here. And it's my prayer as a senior pastor of TLC that we see and we arise the giftings of the apostolic, of the prophetic, of the evangelistic, of the pastoral, and of the teaching, and other gifts that are there, that each one of us learn and ask God, God, can I have a gift? That's what Paul says. He says, desire gifts, desire them, strive after them. Why? Not for yourself or for status, but simply so that you can serve other people and help other people to grow. Those are gifts that God gives. These other things are what we're talking about now is the office. And in fact, some of our English translations talks about that, the office of an elder. Now, it's quite interesting why I read this verse here in Titus 1, 5, 6, and 7 is because these two Greek words are actually interchangeable. They're flipped back and forth here. So just by way of note there, that we can see that it's the office that's the important part here. Okay. I got to finish this off here with Revelation 4, 4. The part on elders before I go to the congregation. Of all positions and offices and titles that we have, for instance, in the Old Testament, you've got prophet, priest, king. New Testament, you've got apostles and prophets and all of that. When everything is said and done, what ends up in heaven? I found this fascinating. If someone can please read Revelation 4:4. Just go ahead and read it nice and loud. Revelation 4:4. You will find many, I think 12 times in the book of Revelation, the word elders pitches up. Doesn't talk about the kings and everybody else. It talks about elders. Why is that so important? Because it's the elders who do the overseeing. God's in charge. Jesus is building his church. This is his church. Okay? No one takes that from Jesus. But Jesus uses and has installed various offices so that the flow of everything works. There has to be some kind of order, and that's what elders do. They provide order and stability, make sure that all the gifts are being utilized. Now, leave that. Let's go to the next slide, because when we install an elder in a congregation, it's very important to know the elder's responsibility, but how about the congregation? Okay. Why do we as believers congregate? Okay, so let's just hear some feedback. Why did you come here this morning? Why do you come every Friday? Worship? Fellowship? Hear from God, pray, edification, tithes. Very few people talk about that. Let's have a few. The next slide, I think, shows it. Some of the things. Acts 2:42 talks about the four basic ones: apostolic teaching, okay, the fellowship, communion, which we're going to have today, and then prayer. In addition to that, here's some other things why we come together. Okay, we come to do singing. Now, a lot of times we say worship. It's true, but I don't know about you, but when I come to church, I like to sing if I can, if my throat is functioning. Does anybody else like to sing? Yeah, yeah. And that's why worship leaders don't sing for us, and they're not supposed to sing at us. They're just supposed to lead us so that we can sing. We are the singers, correct? That's how that works. Testimonies, Lord willing, we'll get that reignited here again, that we take time and listen to testimonies. In the first service this morning, a sister came and she gave a word of prophecy. The Lord gave her a vision, and so she shared that as well. This is what we do in the church because we're Christians and everyone takes part. But something else, tithes and offerings, okay? On that note, can I encourage you as well? You can bring them, okay? But to save a lot of time and energy, you can do the church a favor, do yourself. Just do a direct debit directly from your bank account to the church. If everyone did that, we could save time in counting money. Food for thought. TLC news, we come together, and it used to be that we could only get that here, but thanks to our media team, in addition to getting the news here, if you log on to YouTube, we have that all the news that you see here is always on YouTube as well. So if ever one Friday you miss it or whatever, you can catch up that way. What else we got here? Musical presentations, for example, today at the 11 o'clock, and that's where my wife is this morning. She's a narrator for the musical cantata. And if you're free on Sunday night, I encourage you to come on Sunday night. Don't come alone. Come with a friend. Bring someone with and listen to this cantata. Apparently, it's very, very good. Crystal clear Christian message on that, so it's good to hear. And then there's another reason why many times I like to come to church, and it's simply to get a routine break. It's very easy to run 6, if not 7 days a week and just push, 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 push. And that, to me, at the very, very least, this is a good enough reason to come to church, is to have a break, to relax, to shut the cell phone off, and to be able to sing songs of praise and restore our soul, restore our spirit, and have fellowship with people that'll lift us up. And if we have needs, we can share the needs. So that's at a bare minimum. And then there's lots. I suppose if we sat around longer, we'd come up with some more reasons as to why we come together. Now, the thing is, if you look at this list, possible for one person to do that, right? To provide all these services. In fact, this morning, when I came, of course, this time it's easy to say because my voice is shot and I've been sick for 24 hours. But when I come, even though I'm preaching, that doesn't mean that I'm just come to the service to give. When I come, I take part in the singing. And so our worship team here leads us in worship, and I get ministered to. And even by being ministered helps me then minister. And so each one of us do our part. Do we have the those handouts maybe we could pass out at this time? So this morning, as I said, there's a few things different. In addition to a froggy voice, there's also just a handout for us this morning just to take a look at. And just so that we're all, because I don't know, some of you may be here for a long time, and for some of you, this will be old hat. This is, yeah, we know this, but if you're relatively new, we have a handout for you here just to show you how we are moving forward here at the Lighthouse Church here in Kuwait. So whether we come together as a top row of the people, whether it's 50 people or 80 people or 100 or 300 people or 1,000 people, it doesn't matter. You can see that everyone will come with their own agenda, with their own special need, with their own motive as to why they came. And then what you've got is that second row. is those are the teams that minister. And if you take a look, the arrows are going up. And that is what this service ministry do here at TLC. It's here to service everybody that comes in through the doors to make sure that needs are being met. And sometimes needs aren't always clear. A person may come in and they're bothered with something, and they're being ministered to. Now, sometimes people say, I need this or I need this, but actually they need something else. And it's the Holy Spirit will guide these various people. So we've got preachers, we've got communion servers, service leaders, the prayer team, worship teams, we've got sound and media, ushers, greeters, all these different teams. Then we've got the service ministry leaders team. That would be the leader of each one of those. And they meet every month or every other month just to get together to make sure and ask the question, are these people being serviced? Is it happening? Is it working? And so forth. And that's what the service team leaders meet for, just to make sure that the various teams are all functioning. And then the third category down there, you see service elders. Now, these elders now are the ones who are, what we're installing this morning, Brother Ajith is the one, and together with myself as by jurisdiction of senior pastor, I'll be working together with all the various service elders on this. To make sure that the needs are being met, genuine needs. It's not always wants, it's the issue of needs. Let me skip down to the bottom part, the very bottom. Someone may ask, why is God, or Jesus, the Father, Holy Spirit, at the bottom? Are we minimizing it, the smallest? No, that's not the case. Miriam, if you could, yeah, or Sajid, yeah, if you want to bring it, thanks. If you take a scissors and cut out the pie, okay, this just represents the 11 o'clock service here, okay? And so if we go beside and start doing all the other ones, then you if we could put it up, just if you wouldn't mind just holding it a bit here. This wasn't designed for a big group like this. It's designed for a smaller one. And it's hard to put these things on there because it's even smaller. So it's transform. It's not God's at the bottom and some inobscure thing. But as we put all of our services together, God is the center. John 17:3 says, this is eternal life, that you would know the true living God and his son Jesus Christ. And that can only happen through the power and the working of the Holy Spirit. And that's why we have that dotted line here, and actually we've cut them off on the service elders, because the service elders are the ones who take care of the individual service. And every service will have a different flavor. The 9 o'clock service may have a different flavor than the 11 o'clock. I'm also one of the service elders together with at the 3:30 service. It's the only other one because the 3:30 service has no other conflict with no other time in the Sunday night. And the 3:30 service on Friday is a total different flavor. And Sunday night has a different flavor. Okay, and so we're free to have every service have its own flavor. Now at the center of this, we've got God being a center. We've got our life groups, our prayer, and our Christian education. Now do you remember, as for those of you that went to Sunday school, there was a very, very simple song that says, read your Bible, pray every day if you want to grow. Remember that? A few people nodding. Okay. Reading our Bible and praying are like the two heartbeats, or the pumps that pump the heart. And so as that's true for individual life, we know that if you want to grow as a Christian, you have to read your Bible and you have to pray. I can't have a day. I don't know about you. I can't have a day without reading my Bible and praying. It doesn't happen. It can't happen. Okay, that's in my life as important as breathing. Okay, now not always as long as it should be, but by God's grace, dedicate time. So whatever time you have, I just want to challenge you to increase it a little bit as we grow in Christ. But we've got the life groups, and it's our prayer that the life groups will develop more within TLC. prayer meetings. We've got all kinds of different prayer meetings going on. I want to encourage you as much as possible to come to the various prayer meetings. And if your work schedule doesn't permit you to come to one of the prayer meetings that we now have, I just want to tell you and give you the freedom to start a prayer meeting when you can, because it may be that other people can also only come to that. And so it would be nice to see prayer meetings from TLC 7 days of the week at different time in different places of the city and the country. Okay, just keep that in mind. Christian education can come also into life groups, which are combined, a whole lot more to say. But then we've got the council, and we've got the pastoral staff, admin staff, and we're so thankful to have Brother Shaji here. You're blessed here as the administrator, and he's doing a wonderful job and has really been a great blessing. And so you're blessed in this service to have him here. But he makes sure a lot of this stuff works in here as well, and makes sure it's functioning. So what we've got then is the various services. And so as we are developing, so today we are installing Brother Ajith. And as I said, we never want single leadership. It doesn't happen. Elders is always in plural. Okay. So by jurisdiction, as senior pastor, I'll be joining him. And so when him and I actually get together and talk and update, and he'll be leading then the various service ministry teams and making sure things happen. But it's our prayer that in the coming year, that new elders are brought in and we increase the eldership. Why? Because we believe and have the faith that there's going to be people coming to accept Jesus Christ as personal Lord and Savior, which means the chair that's beside you, which is empty, in a year from now will not be empty. Amen? Amen. There we go. So now when we start having more people in here, there come good logistical problems. And one of the logistical problems to solve is that of leadership. And that's why we always have to be multiplying, looking for more leaders. So we're looking 2, 3, 4, 5 leaders. And once we have enough, then what we do is we split the pie a little bit and we insert another service and for that. And so this is how we keep growing. And so we just keep growing and expanding the circle by God's grace. Okay. Thank you. Thanks so much. So I hope this morning with having this, it just will give you a bird's eye view of how we structure TLC, the direction that we're going. And also, it's my request. I've talked about the first part of the message was about elders. Second part is us as congregation, for each one of us to ask yourself, if you're not already involved in one of these, to ask how you can be involved here at TLC. And don't let the talent that God has given you rust. Okay, you know the old saying, use it or lose it. Yeah, and you don't want to lose it. In fact, you want to hone it, and it's not just for your own good, because what I've noticed sometimes, you know, we say, well, you know, I've got this talent, but no, I'm a bit busy with this. If God has blessed you with a certain talent, it's not just for you to use, okay? Please have it in your heart that you have to use the gift so that others can see it and that you can train others in it as well. All of us, one day will exit, not just Kuwait, we exit life. And what are we passing on to the next generation? And it's so important. That's what Paul is telling with Timothy. Pass this on to others who can teach it to others, who can teach it to others. What gifts has God given you? Use it, not just that you can use it, but that you can teach others as well how to use it and mentor them in that process. I want to close with a charge to the elders. And for this, I'm going to ask Brother Ajith and Sister Shobin to come forward, please. And I've also Sister Joyce and Bevan, if you could come up, please. And we just want to take a few. We're going to be praying in a minute, at which point I'll ask others to join us as well. But just if you come here, please, that way people can see you on both sides. If you stand right here. Sorry, there's going to be a blank spot somewhere. But we've got the next slide, please. Is something that Peter, because when we think of apostolic people. We always tend to gravitate towards Paul, but Peter, being one of the apostles originally with Jesus, makes some very interesting statements specifically about elders, which I find absolutely fascinating. In 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 1 to 4, he says, and I think we have to read the whole thing here to put it into context. So if you have it, please turn to it. If someone again could please read it, give my voice a break. 5, 1 to 4. Just stand up and read it nice and loud, please. Thank you. Here this great apostle says, I, as an elder among you, and it seems to indicate that Peter himself was involved in a local church as an elder. Apostle Paul is a bit different. He was, this, as I mentioned earlier, this trailblazer who would go through in the various towns and cities. But Peter seems to be more locked into a place, so he understood the concept of eldership of a local church, and he says, I, as an elder, like you, appeal to you. He goes on to a few things. Says, take care of the flock God entrusted to you. By implication of that, which he says later, being a shepherd. And in the Old Testament, it was the prophets, priests, and kings, and elders, people in leadership positions, who the generic term was used, shepherds, shepherding God's flock. Now, I just want us to be clear on something, is that shepherds just provide the green pastures and lead the sheep to the green pastures. The primary responsibility of elders of any one of our TLC services is to make sure that Friday after Friday we have men, women of God standing here providing quality, high nutritional food from the Word of God. That there is no hint of malnutrition. But it's up to each one of us if we avail ourselves of that. A shepherd can lead the flock to the greenest of pastures, but he can't eat for them. Everyone has to do that themselves. Lead by your own good example. And so we're thankful for the years of service that Brother Ajith has already given into the church as an elder of TLC, and now specifically for this service. The next slide, please. Also now a charge to the congregation, because as it comes to the elders, it also comes back to each one of us. What is our responsibility? And he says it here. And Peter is known for his direct speech. Doesn't mince too many words. He never did when he was there earlier with Jesus walking on the shores of Galilee. And so now later, nothing much changed. He says, in the same way, you younger men must accept the authority of the elders. In every organization, in every family, in every institution, there is an established set of authority. And as I mentioned earlier, Brother Ajith did not come and say, I want to be an elder and I want this position. He didn't say that. He was approached and asked. And after prayer, he consented to say yes for this season, for this time, as long as God gives him the green light to do so. He will do it. So I just want to thank you for your humility in doing that, saying that. But there's a reciprocal part of that, and that's as a congregation, if each one of us, if we want to grow in Christ, is to simply respect it. Somebody has to do the job, right? And it is an office. It is an office of an elder to coordinate in the facilitating. Just before this meeting and after the last meeting, we had a quick meeting with the service leaders. And I just want to reiterate something that was said there, is that it is our assumption that sitting here in the congregation, there is gold, diamonds, precious stones, perhaps still unmined, unpolished, but it's here. So I just want to encourage each one of us to check our hearts and to unearth the gold that's been buried. And each one develop a leadership under Christ. Now in that picture, in that diagram that we had, I just want something to be clear in here. We cannot assume, okay, just because the arrows are here, all diagrams fall short. If you're dealing with spiritual matters, all earthly two-dimensional diagrams are short. But everyone has direct access to God. We know that. I don't need to say that. I only say it to highlight again the fact that listen to God, what He wants you to do. And then in consultation with the elders, let's work on it. Let's release more gifts here in the body of Christ. And let's watch the Holy Spirit do a new thing here at TLC, and specifically at the 11 o'clock service. I'm excited. Amen. I'm excited about the new things that are coming. And this does not mean, by the way, this does not mean that Brother Ajith will do all the preaching. Okay? So he's going to be watching, listening, and there'll be other people up here preaching here as well. Now, the second part of verse 5, okay, in 1 Peter 5, verse 5, it says here, and he summarizes now, and all of you serve each other in humility. And that's what we want to do. We want to make sure that we all service each other and in humility. It takes, I've been in Africa since 89. I remember being in some places and they told me one thing about an African village. When it comes to raising children, they said, no, not just the mother and father raise a child, but the village raises it. It takes a village to raise up a child, because you got your aunts and uncles and cousins and friends and everyone, and that's how we grow. And the same way when in the body of Christ. We all need each other. We all need each other. Amen? So I'm going to ask us all to stand at this time as we pray. And I'm going to ask the other service leaders and spiritual leaders in this service to please come forward and just surround our brother and sister, and we'll lay hands on you. Yeah, just maybe come on forward just a little bit here. Thanks. Do we have the microphone? Do we have the microphone here somewhere? There it is. And I'm going to ask brothers Saji and also brother Jacob just to lead in prayer and ask God's blessing on them.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, and we thank you for this time to come into your presence once more. We thank you for the good thing that you are doing today, for the new thing that you are doing today. We thank you that in a time before when we saw turmoil and pain, we are now being able to see a smooth, peaceful transition, God. A transition in such that you are leading. You are there, God. I thank you for Ajith Uncle and Shobhana Auntie, Lord, for their lives, for their testimony. You have brought them to this point. You knew it from eternity past, God, that at this point we would be standing here today and praying over them and inducting them as the service elder here. You know the things that they have gone through, the personal suffering and personal pain that they have gone through to reach this point, God. That has not weakened them, but has in fact made them stronger, Lord. Thank you for what you have done, God. Each person here, as a family, help us to support them. Help us to love them. Help us to walk in unity with them. Lord God, because it is not for me or for them, but for your body, for your name, God. And we praise you for that. We praise you, like Pastor Gerald said, for the chairs that are empty now that will be filled again, God. More than the filling of chairs, that the lives that will be saved, that will come in your name, God. And I thank you for what you are doing today. And I praise you and I ask you, God, for all blessings upon this couple. Protect them from head to toe with your angels showering around them, that no attacks of the enemy will come upon them. I ask for this in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus. I ask that you walk with them step by step in every decision, in everything that we do, as we walk together, Lord. We know that you are the head, and we submit to you, God. We praise you. We give you all glory and honor in Christ's mighty name. Amen.
And Father, we just reminded of the scripture where you remind us, Lord, again, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. As we stand here, we thank you for what has happened. And we thank you, Lord, for being a witness of what is happening. And the leaders that you're raising in this church. We thank you this morning, this afternoon, for Minister Ajith and his dear wife. And as they stand here, we pray for a double portion of your anointing, Father. May the Holy Spirit just overwhelm them, Lord, that they may just be able to absorb the spirit of discernment and prophecy and whatever it takes that this church needs to know, that this church needs to grow. We pray that you will use their hands and feet and their heart and their words, Lord, to such a mighty extent, Lord, that the boundaries of this church will know no bounds. And we thank you for each and every one of us in this congregation, that we may learn to move forward to serve you and under the authority of the leadership that you have bestowed upon our church, Lord. We thank you, we praise you. In Jesus' name we pray.
Sister Bebin and Sister Joyce, and I'm going to ask them to lead us in a prayer, praying specifically for the 11 o'clock service, that through this service or in this service, that the Holy Spirit be manifest and become alive. Amen.
Thank you, Father God, for this wonderful gathering of your children for a specific time and purpose. We thank you, Lord, as you've called us, made us in your own image, and your ever so often that we are yours and yours will always be. We ask, Father God, as you always set an example for those that looked up to you, you had a heart, Lord Jesus, that was very evident of the fact that you came as servant God. And we ask, as your children, we would reflect the same heart of servitude towards others. That, Lord, the very foundation, Lord, that we stand on is you. Therefore, we ask, Lord, as the family of Christ, as brothers and sisters, Lord Jesus, when we fellowship, we would do so, Lord, considering ourselves, as Paul reminded us, as the least, Lord Jesus, so that we can look up to others and be able to attribute goodness and credit to the things that others do as well. We ask, Lord, that we would learn to look beyond ourselves towards those that truly need a hand, Lord, that needs to comfort them, lift them up. We call, Lord Jesus, into union with thee, and therefore we ask that as a family we would, Lord, show and witness to others the joy of being called children of the Most High God as we do so, Lord Jesus, in submission to the authority that you've ordained over our lives. We ask, Lord, that the ultimate source of authority would be you, Father God, and Jesus, your Son, who set that example before all else. We ask, Lord, for a mighty covering over this congregation, over the people, Lord, who are your hands and feet that will go out and be witnesses of the gospel. Towards this we ask in your holy and precious name. Amen.
Heavenly Father, Heavenly Father, God, we just thank you that you are an awesome God. We just thank you for all that you have done. Thank you that you're omnipotent, omnipresent, omniscient God. You know all the things before in your hands. And I thank you for all these precious people before your side. I thank you, Lord, for their hearts. I thank you, Lord, for their passion to know you, to serve you, to lead other people, to love you deeper. And I pray that today, oh God, that their love may abound yet more and more in all knowledge, in all discernment, till the day of Christ. That they may not be without, that they will be without offense, oh God. That they will love one another, raise each other, oh God. Raise each other up. Bless each other. Train each other. Encourage each other. That there will be people who will be people of destiny, people, men and women of faith, men and women whom you are leading to find eternity, especially to the lost souls. I thank you, Lord, that you did not leave us, any of us, orphans, Lord, but you have given us a helper, a Holy Spirit, God. The Holy Spirit who will endue us with power from on high, O God. That each one will birth within them a hunger and thirst for righteousness, a hunger and thirst to love you more. I thank you, Lord, that this is your church, and the gates of hell will not prevail in it, God. And we are standing on a solid rock, for you are the Lord of lords. You are the rock. And we just thank you, Lord, that you will do things beyond what we can ever imagine in this place, in this church, Lord. I thank you that you are making all things new, God. And you are preparing the way for greater things to come. For everything, Lord, we give you honor and glory and all praise. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
I must say that we are really humbled this afternoon. As we just heard the prayer, God is an awesome God, and He's a sovereign God. And we want to thank God first for what He's doing in TLC, what He has done, and what He's yet doing. I believe we are going to see greater days ahead, and not by our own strength, but by the strength of Him who is able to do great things. Mighty exploits shall be seen what God will do. We take it seriously. As you heard the heaviness of Pastor's voice with which he called this to be today, and we want to say to you that we really take joy knowing that we have all of you in our lives now. And we take joy in that, and take joy in serving each and every one. You know, last Sunday we were at the 6 o'clock service, and Pastor Martin and his wife, Sister Loida, we were talking to them where we usually sit in the sanctuary and parish hall. If you know, we always sit in the parish hall side. Pastor Martin looked at the chairs and said, "Brother Ajith, these chairs were flat, but now they have taken a curve," he said, meaning to say, over 3+ decades, we have sat there, the same side, almost the same pew, and almost the same seat. So, after 3+ decades, to make a move, when Pastor Gerald spoke about this, we took time to pray, and we did pray, and we felt comfortable with what we heard, that no matter where God places us as servants to serve Him, in serving you, in serving this congregation, we serve the Lord, and we do that with joy. Well, there are 3 things that we intend doing. We intend to get to know each one of you sooner than later, right? Some of you we already know from quite some time, but some of you we need yet need to get to know you. And second thing, what we intend, both of us, serving you, being available to you. Whatever God would have us do, we make ourselves available. And the third thing that we intend doing is to put our hands together with yours to the plow in the vineyard of our master. These are the three things that we intend doing. Well, I heard what Pastor Josh said last time when he spoke. He said he had been reminding the congregation who you are in Christ Jesus. I think that reminder will continue because we are seeing that God has equipped you, God has gifted you, and you carry the anointing. So we thank God for that and to be a part of this family. And I believe, without an exception, each and every one of you, you are a leader. You might not know that, but you are. And I believe together we can fulfill God's calling. This very place to be still, as TLC Mishref, is God's doing. We would have lost this. I know what's behind that. God did not permit that. It is for a reason. And we really glorify God for that. Well, our prayer is that God would bind us with cords that can never be broken, no matter what. Ups and downs that we may go through. But still, that, and also that each one of us be to each other, as we read, I think it is 1 Peter 5:5, that we be to each other comfort, strength, brother and a sister always. That's our prayer. So we take this as a privilege for us to be a servant of the Most High God, to be at this time an instrument in His hands to do whatever He would have us do. Thank you.